Good morning. Good to see you in the house of the Lord this morning. I'm going to invite you to stand and join us in singing hymn 386, Brethren, We Have Met to Worship.
Brethren, we have met to worship and adore the Lord our God. Will you pray with all your power while we try to preach the word? All is vain unless the Spirit of the Holy One comes down.
Christ will gird himself and serve us with sweet manna all around.
Amen. You can join us in singing hymn 338. 338, Wonderful Words of Life.
Sing them over again to me. Wonderful words of life. Let me more of their beauty see. Wonderful words of life. Words of life and beauty. Teach me faith and duty. Beautiful words, wonderful words. Wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Christ the Blessed One gives to all wonderful words of life. Sinnerless to the loving call, wonderful words of life. Also freely given, wooing us to
Hymn 446, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his Spirit.
Perfect submission, all is at rest. I am my Savior and happy and blessed. You may be seated. That kid is very funny. I want to encourage you to stand once again and join Sanctuary.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary.
Sanctuary for our God. Remain standing for a reading of the word.
Today I'll be reading from the book of John, chapter 3, verses 28 through 30. You yourselves bear me witness that I said, I am not the Christ, but I have been sent before him. The one who has the bride and who has the bride is the bridegroom. The friend of the bridegroom who stands and hears him, rejoices greatly at the bridegroom's voice. Therefore, this joy of mine is now complete. He must increase, but I must decrease. May God bless the reading of his word. You may be seated.
This morning, we want to honor all of our veterans with salute to the armed forces. So as I call out your branch of the military, would you please stand and be recognized? The United States Army. United States Air Force.
Under, walk with God, terrible roar.
the United States Marine Corps. So we can recognize you.
Amen. Remain standing, and we thank you. I had the joy Thursday night to go and speak at the Historical Society on giving thanks, and it was a time that they honored and recognized the veterans. And just sitting there among World War II veterans, Korean War veterans, Vietnam veterans, I tell you, it just filled my heart with such just a sense of joy and just proud to be around those men and women. And that's how I feel about you men. And God bless you. Thank you for serving, and thank you for being so honorable in your service. And we give thanks today for the freedoms that we enjoy because of men and women like you. So God bless you and thank you for your service. Amen. Amen.
Gonna live like a believer, turn my back on the deceiver.
Children can be dismissed. Caroline, that was excellent. And I'm glad you sang that song. It ties right in with our message today. So thank you so much for blessing us and challenging us to really live for Jesus. And today, if you have your Bibles, I want you to turn with me to John chapter 6. This is one of those passages that as I reread it, read it again, went through each verse. It was just one of those sections that just, it leaves you feeling like you've been stung. You know, I hear people say, boy, that was a good message. You really stepped on my toes. And, I'm like, well, I don't know how to approach that. But I'm going to tell you, as I read it, I was stepping on my toes. The Lord was stepping on my toes. This is a message that really challenges us to ask a difficult question. And I'm going to pose that question to you in just a moment. This message is for all of us. I'm not preaching at you. This is for all of us. It's quite a bit of passage here. John chapter 6 is 71 verses. We're going to be looking at almost 50. I promise I'm going to move quickly. We're going to move through quickly. Several years ago, there was a campaign that was started entitled, I Am Second. A lot of professional athletes, a lot of people that were well-known who were believers were a part of this campaign. And to show their decision, they would wear a little bracelet. And on that bracelet would be the words, I am second. And what that represented is they were saying, though I am a professional, though they may have been a superstar in some sport, they were acknowledging that there was someone else who was first. They were second. And Jesus is first. That Jesus is first in their life. And as I read this passage and I went over and over, that kept coming to my mind. And it was as though the Lord was saying to me, why is Jesus wearing an I am second bracelet when connected to your life? And I believe that if we were honest, the idea, I am second, yes, attain it. But in practice, is it a reality? In practice, if we were honest, would we have to admit, I'm not wearing an I am second bracelet, Jesus is wearing it. If I'm honest, I have to admit that I'm usually wearing I'm first. I'm number one. And Jesus, as he deals with this crowd, he deals with a group that claimed to be wearing an I am second bracelet, but really, in practicality, they were number one, and he wasn't. When you come to verse 20 of this chapter, it says, on the following day. Now, the following day, the day before, is the day that Jesus performed a remarkable miracle. He created food. You food famine? I know you're hungry. Jesus made food. He fed thousands. When it was all said and done, they started with a few loaves and fishes. Next thing you know, they've got 12 baskets of full food to take with them. And the people are so amazed by the supernatural that they said, let's make him king. And Jesus didn't want to have anything to do with that. And he departed. He went up to the mountain. That night as he's praying, he had told his disciples, go on across the sea and I'll meet you there. And you know the rest of the story, that night they went out, it became very turbulent, and that's the night Jesus walked on water, and Peter did his little water walking thing, and they get to the other side. Now, imagine, this has all happened. Those people have a full belly, they slept well through the night, and they're thinking, man, free buffet in the morning. Woo, free buffet. We've got the greatest chef in all the world, and he is making food. He's creating food out of nothing. I can't wait to see what is on the menu in the morning. And they get up, and he's gone. They go down to the seashore, it says, verse 20. too, on the following day, when the people who were standing on the other side of the sea saw that there was no other boat there except the one which which his disciples had entered, and that Jesus had not entered the boat with the disciples, but had gone away alone. However, other boats came from Tiberias, near the place where they ate bread after the Lord had given thanks. Here the word has gotten out. Folks down in Tiberias, they're hearing, man, there's free food. And so let's go. And they're on their way. They get there. Jesus, the miracle worker, is gone. And so they do the natural thing. Verse 24, when the people therefore saw that Jesus was not there, nor his disciples, they also got into boats and came to Capernaum seeking Jesus. Now that sounds real spiritual. You hear somebody say, man, I'm seeking Jesus. Well, praise the Lord. Well, maybe not always. They said they were going there to seek Jesus. Really? Were they really seeking Jesus? And why were they seeking Jesus? Well, verse 25. And when they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, Rabbi, when did you come here? It's almost like, what's going on? You belong over there. We hadn't had breakfast yet. You know, who do you think you are? We were waiting on you, and we were expecting things. And so Jesus, just to show their seeking was not genuine, he tells us this. In verse 26, he said, most assuredly I say to you, you seek me not because you saw the sign, but because you ate of the loaves and were filled. He said, you're just after the temporal. You're not really seeking me. If you were seeking me, this would not be about putting food in your bellies. You would be wanting me to take over your life. In verse 27, he gives them an admonition. He said, do not labor for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to everlasting life, which the Son of Man will give you, because God the Father has set his seal on him. He is saying to this crowd, don't exchange the temporal for the eternal. Don't enjoy the short-lived thrills more. Don't enjoy short-lived thrills more than long-term results. He's saying, you just want something that lasts for a few moments, and 3 hours later, you need the same thing again. He said, I'm here to offer you something that lasts forever. And could I just give an application here as a parent? A fellow parent, and maybe to grandparents, I'm about to be one. Is there any nurses in the room? Is it true that on full moons they have more babies? Well, I was afraid you'd say, yes, it is. Now, come on, Karen. I know that's an old wives' tale. I was hoping it was factual. Our daughter-in-law is close. I mean, they almost kept her Thursday. I was over there at the hospital, and I was coming back, and Dan said, Dad, I think they may induce. And I just did a U-turn right there in the highway and made my way back to Lexington. And so I'm pulling for this supermoon to do something super. And but anyway, as a parent and a future grandparent, and I've been there and failed in this, and then I've had victory in it. You know, Just remind you, we had four children, and we reared four, and we did good at times, and we did pretty bad at times, and we're still doing it. And, being in the ministry, I can remember those moments of getting four kids bathed and fed and to church, and getting to church, and the church I was at the time was a church that you set up the chairs. You didn't just walk in and have church. You had to set chairs up, and you had to get everything set up. And I mean, you're rambling and rushing to get there for Wednesday night prayer meeting. And by the time you get there, you look at yourself and you think, did I take a shower in my clothes or what? You know, I mean, just trying to get there and the sacrifice of that. But then having children that were involved in things, involved in sports, involved in all kinds of activities, making choices. Do we go this route? Do we follow this pathway? And then you go down that pathway and you realize we can't keep this pace, and this isn't healthy for our family, and this isn't healthy for their spiritual life, and having to make some difficult choices. And folks, here's what I want to talk about today. I'm dealing with the question. This is not one of those questions about both and. This is one about either or. That's what I'm dealing with, the question here. The question I'm about to ask you, this isn't a both and. I mean, we've been in situations you could do both and. You could keep your relationship with the Lord strong. You could be involved in church and do this. I've been on vacation where we did both and. You know, being on vacation didn't mean we took a vacation from church. We found a church, and we would make time and go worship while we were on vacation. It was a both and. I'm dealing with, this is an either or. This is that moment where you either allow Christ to be number one or you don't. Either you follow Him and you commit to that ministry or that relationship with Him, or you don't. Now, here's just an application. Here's the challenge. Here's the caution. Parents, don't sacrifice your kids at the altar of sports, entertainment, recreation, etc., at the detriment of their spiritual condition. Relationship with God, when it is sacrifice, it subconsciously teaches to our children that other things can take precedence over Jesus. It has the potential to lead to an adult that drifts when they face a world of challenges, decisions that cannot be solved by what they learned on the football field or the basketball floor or the other activity. Those secondary events that they can learn profitable things about discipline and perseverance, but things that cannot be solved, that cannot be dealt with through these secondary things, but can only be faced with what they learn at the feet of Jesus. At the feet of Jesus, when He has undivided acknowledgement. Can I just put it in one sentence? When confronted with a choice between Jesus, ministry, your church family, or sports, recreation, entertainment, and hang on, because I know yesterday was opening deer season, and I was out there like all the others, waiting on that deer to find me, and he didn't find me, or hunting. When we are confronted with a choice between Jesus, ministry, our church commitment, or sports, recreation, entertainment, hunting, etc., here's my question. Who wins out? Who wins out? I'm just asking you to be real honest this morning. I'm telling you, this is a stinging passage. Who wins out the majority of the time? Who wins out? I'm asking you, is He first? Is He first? Or does He always come in second? When it comes down to an either-or choice, who wins out? Because I'm afraid that many times Jesus has to go put that I am second bracelet back on. And He shouldn't. Is He first? Is He first? Several years ago, Owen County experienced something that hadn't been experienced maybe ever or hadn't happened in years. We had a football team that went 10-0. They ended up 11-1. It was a great year. Excitement. Some of you may not realize that, but when that season started, there were a few guys on that team that went to their coach and said, "Coach, when Wednesday rolls around, we want practice to be wrapped up in time that we can be involved in our youth group at church." You know what that coach said? He said, we can make it happen. We can make it happen. You know what it took? It took some young people saying, and these were some of the star players on the team. They said, "Coach, we're going to make this a priority. We're not going to eat, drink, and sleep football. This is not going to be our God. Jesus is our God. And we're going to make time." And those young men were here when youth time started. Through the years, that has changed. Now it's just like practice through. Up, can't be at youth group because we've got ball practice. We got basketball practice. We got football practice. I'm just saying there comes a time that we need to say this is an either or, and sometimes it means having to make a difficult choice. My wife is an excellent basketball player. She played 1 year of college basketball, set the new record at that school. They were playing the School of the Blind down in Mississippi. And she set a new scoring record for that school. She was a ball player. She could play. And in junior high, she was starting player. During that junior high year, Dad was pastor. She missed a whole tournament because she told the coach, "My church is having revival this week. I will not be at the games." The next year, the high school coach said, "Now we're going to deal with something right off the bat. If you're not ready to make basketball everything, if you're not ready to eat, drink, and sleep it, if you're not ready to be involved in it, and it takes precedence over everything," and he even kind of mentioned church. Libby went up to him and said, "Well, I guess I will not be playing." That was the end of her basketball playing time. Because she realized this was not a both and that this coach was willing to work at. It was going to be either or. It was either going to be basketball or my relationship with Jesus and my involvement in my youth and involvement in my church. And she made the decision, it's going to be Jesus. I've so wished that we had videos of when she played college ball. I'd like to send it to that coach and say, "Look at what you missed out on." She made a choice. It meant a sacrifice. What I'm challenging us today is when we are faced with the choice, who wins out? Does Jesus always come up short on the stick? Does he have to always wear the "I am second" bracelet? Are we willing to take a stand and say, "Jesus is number one, this is secondary, this will not be primary"? That's what Jesus is dealing with in this passage. Well, look what happened to verse 28 as we move on rather quickly. Verse 28, "Then they said to him, 'What shall we do that we may work the works of God?'" I mean, they're convicted. And they said, "Well, okay, we got to do something. We got to prove to him that we're not like that." And then Jesus answers in verse 29. He said, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he sent." He said, "Work. I don't want you to do something. I want you to believe something. I don't want you to do something. I want you to yield to me. I want you to believe in me, that I have the seal of God upon my life and that I deserve to be the rightful master of your life, master over sports, master over food, master over entertainment and recreation." So verse 30, "Therefore they said to him, 'What sign will you perform then, that we may see it and believe?'" What work will you do? You ever think Jesus just said, "Am I dealing with morons?" Did they not hear what I just said? It's like they avoid and they change the subject and they're saying, "Well, I tell you what, you prove yourself and then we'll consider your request. Prove yourself that you're Jesus. Do some sign." Jesus could have said, "Have I not already proven myself? Yesterday, I made food out of nothing. I filled your bellies. And you're wanting something else. You're putting me to the test." Then they move on to verse 31. "Our fathers ate the manna in the desert. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." You know what they were saying? They were saying, "Jesus, really what we want the winning numbers on the lottery. That's all we want. We just want free stuff. We want blessings from heaven. We want food. We want our team to win the game. We want a job. We want our debt erased. But, you know, this thing about wanting you, we just want what you offer." Jesus said, "No, what you need is you need me. You need me." Verse 29, "Jesus answered and said to them, 'This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he sent.'" This is what Jesus desires, that we desire him and that we make him our master. And no, in turn, they want something different. Verse 32, they then say, "Most assuredly, I say to you, Moses did not give you the bread from heaven," or Jesus is responding, "but my Father gives you the true bread from heaven." It's like they were saying, "Hey, Jesus, can you top Moses? Can you top what Moses did?" They're tempting him. And Jesus said, "Listen, guys, Moses didn't do anything. It was the Heavenly Father who did it. And let me tell you, I'm greater than Moses. You have such respect and esteem for Moses. Do you not realize that the one who is standing before you deserves greater respect and admiration than Moses?" Verse 33, for the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives light to the world. It's like, let me repeat something, guys. It's me that you need, and it means totally yielding to me. You're looking for the wrong kind of bread. It lasts a few hours. I'm offering you bread that lasts forever. Verse 34, then they said to him, Lord, give us this bread always. It's like they can't make the transition. He's talking about something eternal, and they're still thinking about something temporal. He's talking about food from heaven. They're talking about food from earth. It's like they can't comprehend. They're not making the transition. And then verse 35, Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger. He who believes in me shall never thirst. He is saying what you need is a Jesus relationship, and that relationship provides fullness. It provides contentment. It provides what you are seeking in temporal means. In verse 36, but I said to you that you have seen me and yet you do not believe. They saw, they heard, and they did not believe. They did not see. They did not yield. And then verse 37, he says, all that the Father gives me will come to me, and the one who comes to me I will by no means cast out. He is saying, I am giving you an assurance. I am giving you a guarantee that I'll never let you down. You yield to me and you'll not be disappointed. You yield to that team, you're going to be disappointed. They're going to lose. You yield to that coach, he's going to let you down. You yield to those friends, they're going to disappoint you. You yield to your plans, it won't go as planned. You yield to that trip that you planned, you get there and realize, man, it was more fun planning it than it was doing it. And he says, all of those things will let you down, but I won't. I assure you, I won't. Verse 38, for I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And I tell you, folks, if Jesus followed that pattern, should we not follow the same pattern? He said, I came down to follow the will of the Father. What is our plan? We should follow the will of the Son. We ought to make him number one. We ought to let him be the Lord of our life. Verse 39, he said, this is the will of the Father who sent me, that of all he has given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise it up at the last day. He said, what I'm offering is permanent. What I'm offering is eternal. What I'm offering is something that will have a lasting impression on your life that all of these secondary things will not do. Ask them. There are professional athletes that have reached the pinnacle. There are businessmen who have sat on the top of their business. There are actors who have made it to the top, and they come to know Christ, and their testimony is always the same. Everything that I looked for in that fell short. But Christ is what I was always longing for and looking for. Verse 41, what happens when he makes this challenge? When he brings them to a place of choice, what happens? I'll tell you what happens. People get angry. Look at verse 41. Then the Jews, this would have been the religious leaders, the Jews then complained about him. They complained about him. They were mad. They were saying, who are you to tell us to yield completely to you? Isn't that how the old flesh reacts? If I preach a sermon about what the Bible says about women submitting to their husbands, you know what? Sometimes as a woman, you get mad, don't you? Don't you tell me to submit to him, you know? I mean, it's that old nature. You know, you tell somebody, hey, son, you're going to submit to the authority at school. Don't tell me that. I'm going to obey the law. I can do whatever I want to. Well, Jesus tells them, make me Lord. I'm to be number one. You're the one that's supposed to be wearing the I am second bracelet. And the Jews, the religious leaders, are angry. These leaders represent, folks, everything that is tugging at you and trying to move you away from him. They represent everything that would cause you to deny him, doubt him, deceive you about him. It's there. This world is saying, hey, you got to put your kids in this. They got to be doing this. They have to, you know, you may just have to deny time with the Lord, and you can't be in church anymore. But the time will come when they get older. You can get back to that. No, you won't. And the kids won't. Something is lost. There's something that is taught. They catch it. You can make a choice to let Jesus be second rather than first in situations. And before long, subconsciously, they just say, well, it's not that big a deal to to neglect Christ, to neglect my call, to neglect my relationship, to neglect my time with God's people and involvement in ministry. It's not worth it. Verse 42, and they said, is not this Jesus the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How is it then that he says, I have come down from heaven? I'm going to tell you, these are words that they were basically speaking down. They were making less and lower. That who is this man? Who does he think he is? We know his dad. We know his mother. He's a nobody. Who is he to claim to be Lord and Master? Verse 43, Jesus recognized it. He said, why don't you stop your grumbling? Do not murmur among yourselves. Verse 44, no one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up at the last day. He says, stop grumbling and start responding. Stop arguing about me being Lord. Stop putting yourself in a quandary of a choice. Should we do it or not? Just don't do it. Make me Lord. Just respond to me. Verse 45 through 51 then goes into a moment where Jesus is reviving and driving home the point that they need to receive and partake of him, and that he alone is the lasting one that fulfills the void, because he uses terminologies there about, listen to what he says in verse 45, it is written in the prophets, and they shall be taught by God. Therefore, everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that anyone has seen the Father except he who is from God. He has seen the Father. Verse 47, most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me has everlasting life. I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness and they're dead. You know what he's saying? You want the secondary stuff. And here's where it leads. It leads to death. But I'm offering you something that leads to life. Make me master. Make me number one. Verse 50, this is the bread which comes down from heaven, and that one may eat of it and not die. I'm the living bread which came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I shall give is my flesh, which I shall give for the life of the world. And then the Jews, so dumb, they couldn't even comprehend. He was dealing with terminology in the realm of the spiritual and giving a figurative term, and they said, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? They're so caught up in the earthly and temporal that they didn't comprehend what he was even saying. Verse 53, then Jesus said to them, most assuredly I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise them up at the last day. For my flesh is food indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. As the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so he who feeds on me will live because of me. This is the bread which came down from heaven, not as your fathers ate the manna and are dead. He who eats this bread will live forever. These things he said in the synagogue as he taught in Capernaum. He was saying, folks, you need to be filled with me. You need to totally consume me. You need to totally yield to me. I'm not just to be something you add on to your life at some level with everything else that's cluttering your life. I'm to be on a scale above all. It's not Jesus, entertainment, athletics, all of these things. We're not on the same plane. He said, I'm number one. I'm master. And you're making choices that basically lowers me to a level below all of this temporal stuff, and you're going to find yourself still hungry, still empty. Then, verse 60, therefore many of his disciples, when they heard this, said, this is a hard saying. Who can understand it? They were like, man, this is tough. Let me tell you, when you come to those either-or situations, I'm not talking little, these are little easy things. That wasn't easy for my wife when she, something she had a passion for and love for, and had to come to a choice to say, no, Christ is going to be number one. That wasn't an easy task. They said, this is hard. And Jesus, verse 61 said, Jesus, when he knew in himself that his disciples complained about this, he said to them, does this offend you? I can't imagine how he said that to him. He said, does it offend you? It offends you that I'm requesting to be the Lord of your life? It offends you. You have seen what I've been doing. You have heard what I've been saying. I'm going to give my life on behalf of you. I'm going to send back to the Father. You're going to see it. I don't know if that's going to change your attitude or not. But you're offended because I'm calling you. I'm calling you to follow me unconditionally. I'm asking you to make me master and Lord and not allow me to be second place anymore or be neglected anymore. That offends you. Verse 62, what then if you should see the Son of Man ascend where he was before? He said, ascension's coming. I just wonder, will that even get your attention? Verse 63, it is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak to you are spirit and they are life. But there are some of you who do not believe. For Jesus knew from the beginning they were who they were who did not believe and who would betray him. And he said, therefore I've said to you that no one can come to me unless it had been granted to him by the Father. And then look at verse 66. And from that time, many of his disciples went back and they walked with him no more. They said, this is going to be an either or, huh? Well, we think we're just going to go back home. What you're asking is too much. Because I want to be number one. And they went back home. And folks today in hell, they regret. They regret that they went back home. What about us? When we have a choice, either or, who wins? What sacrifice have we made? Tonight we're going to come back and watch a video. And we're going to be ashamed, I'm afraid. I can't even give up going to that movie because it's the same time youth group. It's the same time of Sunday night service. It's the same time of some ministry opportunity that I need to be at. We can't even sacrifice going to the movie. We can't even sacrifice going to our coach and say, listen, coach, I'm going to work hard. I'm going to be the best player I can be. But come Wednesday night, I'm going to be in my church youth group. Making some choices where Christ wins out. Now, why is it that he does wear I am second bracelet? I'm going to give it to you really quick, so hang on. I'll tell you why. It's because truth offends. Truth offends. They were offended because truth is exclusive. God the Father said he would be a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. The devil resists truth. That's why it's hard when we make that choice. Our fallen nature refuses it. It loves sin. It loves tradition over truth. It loves being number one. And so therefore, that's why he's stuck wearing the I am second bracelet. I want to tell you, number two, we're more comfortable with religion than we are a relationship. We like rules and rituals, and if we break them, we don't feel so bad. But when it comes to relationship and we break that, it hurts a little more. So we make him second. Number three, we're looking for a magic genie rather than a master. He's convenient when I'm collapsing. We just treat Jesus like he's a genie in a bottle. We rub it. Come out, genie. I need you now. I need you. You're number one. Earthly benefits seem to rule the day, so we treat him like he's some magician that just makes everything good. Number four, we're still trapped by the temporal instead of the eternal. We long for popularity. We long for prestige. We long for greatness. We want fame. We want all of that that's not lasting instead of the eternal. Number five, our sin rebels at total surrender. Number six, our priorities are misplaced. We start with the secondary and work in the primary. That's what we do. Folks, we got to do it opposite. We start with the primary. Jesus, number one. Now, can any of this other stuff fit in? Can it be a both and? Well, yeah, it sure can. We can still work. We can do that. We can do that without neglecting our Lord and neglecting our faith and neglecting our service and neglecting our worship. We've got to start with Jesus primary and work in the secondary. And if they don't work in, you let them work out. That's tough. We had to make that choice with our oldest son. Love basketball, talented. We got into that mindset. Oh, yeah, you got to be on this team. You got to do this. You got to travel. You got to go here, go here. Oh, we did that. About wiped our family out. About wiped our finances out. But, oh, you got to do that. If you ever want them to be, you know, do all this other stuff. We had to come to choice, say, you know what? We can't do that. Our faith is number one. Our family is up there. And we had to make a choice. You know what? He did fine. He did fine. We knew he wasn't going to be a next NBA superstar. But we had to make a choice. And it meant, no, we can't. You can't be on these teams. No, you can't do that. Because we're not going to let it diminish our faith relationship and our family relationship. Number seven. Why does he wear the second I am second bracelet? Because Jesus is not supremely valued. He's not supremely valued. If we valued him the way he deserves, we would not even struggle with the choices. It'd be like, this is no-brainer, folks. Jesus or doing that? That's a no-brainer. It's a no-brainer. Last of all, we don't recognize him for who he really is. They didn't recognize him for who he really was. He was a magic man. He was a miracle worker. He was a food creator. But they didn't recognize him for who he was. He was the Lord Almighty. Today you may be here and you are a Christian, but you realize, you know, as I think of the choices in my life when it came, will it be Christ? Will it be ministry? Will it be my worship of God with fellow believers? Will that be the priority of our lives? Or this? And you realize, you know what? The or this is winning out. It's winning out majority of the time. Today you may need to come and say, God, I want you to renew my heart. Forgive me because all this bread of the world that I'm eating, all of this stuff, all this involvement, all this activity that's pulling us here and there and everywhere, it's torn our family up, it's put us in financial straits. It's empty. And I need living bread. Man, I encourage you parents with these little ones, you've got to start now making some boundaries. Your greatest intention right now, you're going to be pressed and pressured to give in to it down the road. And don't. It is not worth it. I'm on the other side of some of that now. It was not worth it. It is not worth it. And you've got to make a renewed commitment today about this as a Christian. You may be here, though, and you're not saved. Don't be like these false disciples. Come today and realize that Christ offers to you something that is lasting, that is fulfilling. Salvation is offered to you today to be saved. The bread the world offers, it turns out to be stale. It doesn't last. Come to Christ and be saved. It's time for Jesus to take off the I Am Second bracelet when it comes to our life and put on I Am First in our life. What do you need to do today? What renewal do you need to make? Maybe something public you need to come. Publicly pronouncing, I want Christ to be number one. And I'm sorry that he has not been number one. If you need to be saved, step out from where you are and let me talk with you and pray with you and help you make the greatest decision you'll ever make to make Christ the Lord of your life. You come as the Lord leads. We're going to sing together hymn number 415, Room at the Cross. And there he is. There's room at the cross for all of us. You come. Come to the cross this morning. Come and do what the Spirit of God is calling you to do this morning as we stand and as we sing. Amen. Well, I hope I see you tonight. Come and join us, 7 o'clock, for the Insanity of God movie. And don't miss it. I think you will find your faith enlarged and amazed at what God has done and is doing across this world. This week, let's make a decision. God, as I have a choice, I'm going to make you number one. When I get to one of those either ors, it's going to be Jesus. Let's do it this week. Let's step out of our comfort zone when it comes to something of that nature. And I tell you, what a testimony that'll be. What a testimony. I tell you, I've never been more proud. That year, those boys said, Coach, we're going to be at youth meeting. I was proud of those boys. That took guts. Took a stand. Man, let's do that for His glory and for His honor. Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank You for Your word. Today's passage, Lord, was stinging in many ways. Lord, it confronted me with the times that I gave in to the culture, to the call of the world, and gave in to the pressure. And I made Jesus become second. Forgive me, Lord. And I pray that You would help our young parents as they have a journey ahead of them, that they will be confronted with the same choices. God, help them to stand. Help them to see You honor faith. You bless when Christ is exalted. Give them courage. Help our young people, Lord, to have a faith that will help them to stand out and step up and make Jesus number one. Lord, making the sacrifice when it's called upon. And Lord, that You might change the heart of others and coaches and other folks that are involved in things of this nature to see that this matters. It makes a difference when our young people are allowing Christ to be the Lord of their life. And be with all of us, from the oldest to the youngest in this room, that this week when we are faced with a choice, help us to let Christ win out. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.